I'll let you introduce your folks and the title of the talk.
Yeah, thank you. Hello from my side. My name is Mike. I'm a PhD student from Halle in Germany, and I would like to talk about sparse pairwise re-ranking with pre-trained transformers, which is joint work with Lukas Gienab, Matthias Hagen, and Martin Potthast. During our work, the main motivation was that pairwise ranking models like Duo-T5 or Duo-Bird are very, very effective, but slow. So they are very inefficient. And so we wanted to ask the question, can we make them faster while maintaining their good effectiveness? So we want to have a Duo-Bird or Duo-T5, which has the same effectiveness, but is more efficient. And that's the goal, what we want to achieve, or at least what we want to work at. And let me give you a bit of background for this story. So just a bit history for feature-based learning to rank models, we saw an evolution from point-wise learning to rank models to pair-wise learning to rank models, and then finally to list-wise learning to rank models. And the interesting part here is that this evolution took in to the most extent part on the loss function. So from the inference point of view, most of those models still use a single query and a single document as input. But now this transition from the point-wise to pair-wise models with pre-trained transformers are slightly different. So for example, when we look at the point-wise retrieval model Mono-T5, we have as input still the query Q and the document D, and the output then is the probability that the document D is relevant to the query. But what is now interesting is that for the pairwise retrieval model Duo-T5 or Duo-Bird, the input changes for the inference. So we have as input a query Q and a document pair DA and DB. And as output, we then produce a pairwise preference. So we can see this for, or in the case of Duo-T5, as the probability that document DA is more relevant to the query Q than document DB. And the interesting part here is now that because we have document pairs as input, we have to, or at least the default implementation of Duo-T5 has to compare this pairwise preferences for all document pairs in the set of the documents that we want to re-rank. So it's very inefficient. And in fact, it is the case that if we want to re-rank K documents with Duo-T5, we have to make K square minus K pairwise comparisons. And but it is worth it because if we look at the effectiveness of Duo-T5 here on MS Marco on the passage data set on the deep learning track 2019 and 20, we get an effectiveness of NDCGA10 of 0.67. And if we would only use Mono-T5, so the point-wise thing, we would only get 0.5. But this costs us 2,450 additional pairwise inferences that we have to make. And the goal of this talk is, or of this paper, was to maintain this very good effectiveness of Duo-T5, but reduce the number of inferences that we have to make for Duo-T5. And for that, we use the pipeline, or the Mono-Duo pipeline proposed by Pradeep et al. And the pipeline basically works in four steps. So the first step is to do a baseline retrieval, for example, with BM25 on the whole corpus. Then the next step is to do the point-wise re-ranking, for example, with Mono-T5, and to re-rank the top 1,000 documents there. Then comes the part on which we focus in our talk, so the pairwise re-ranking, where we want to re-rank the top 50 documents. And because it's the main focus of our talk, I want to give more details on the different steps of this pairwise re-ranking thing. So first, we assemble all the document pairs that we want to compare. The assembling of the document pairs where we say, okay, I want to make the pairwise predictions for document D1 and D2, D2 and D1, and so on and so on. And these are K square minus K comparisons that we assemble in the default case. After we have assembled the comparisons, we do the pairwise inference with Duo T5, where we simply ask the model, okay, given the query and document D1 and document D2, what is the preference? So we do all the pairwise preferences. And when we have done the pairwise preferences, we have the preference scores and we have to aggregate them to some a single score of each document. So the last thing is the score aggregation. And if we have this aggregated scores, we can then finally rank the documents by the aggregated scores. So this is the full MonoDuo pipeline. And we focus on two things. First, the efficiency. And in order to improve the efficiency, we focus on the assembling of the pairwise or of the comparisons. So this is the first step in this pipeline. So by default, we would have an quadratic complexity here. And we just want to make this set of comparisons sparser by removing some maybe redundant comparisons so that we have or so that we can make the inference more effective. More efficient by leaving out some comparisons. And we don't make any changes to the pairwise inference, but we make some changes to the score aggregation, or at least we test several score aggregation methods to improve the effectiveness. Because when we change the assembling of the comparisons, then the aggregation of the scores has also some impact on the final ranking. So we just test for different score aggregation methods there. So this is the focus of the rest of the talk. So first the efficiency and then the effectiveness. When we think about, okay, what would be the best thing that we could do efficiency wise, then the best solution that we could hope for would a sorting algorithm. For example, there is quicksort with K, which is just like quicksort with Q, but can use pairwise preferences as input. And the interesting point there would be that it would be efficiency-wise the best thing that we can do. So it, because it would have an complexity of n times log n, which would be much better than n square from the previous approach. And in order, or so we could apply such a sorting approach when the pairwise predictions that we do would fulfill some properties or requirements. So we would basically need that the pairwise predictions would form a total order. And for that, we just look, okay, if Duo T5 fulfills such properties. So we look into two properties. First, are the predictions consistent? And second, are they transitive? And with consistency here, I mean, if I have a document pair that I want to score DA and DB, then it should not matter if I put in, switch the order of the documents. So it should not matter if I put in DA and DB or DB and DA, because the scores should be inverse of each other when the model would be consistent. And transitivity in this sense just means, okay, for all sets of three documents, the pairwise predictions should be transitive. And if I would have both properties, I could reliably apply such sorting algorithms at a very, very good efficiency. We do evaluate whether Duo T5 or the degree to which Duo T5 fulfills both properties. And we find that only 50% of the document pairs on MS Marco are consistent. So this means Duo T5 makes inconsistent predictions, and it indeed is important, or the order of the documents is indeed important. So it makes a difference if I put in DA and DB or DB and DA. And it is also not perfectly transistent. So this means for all pairs of, or for all document sets with three documents in there, we have a transistency of 70% on average. So this means it does not look very good that we can apply sorting approaches. And indeed, when we just use Duo T5 with this quicksort approach, we are very efficient. So we only use 85 comparisons compared to previously 2,450. But the effectiveness in terms of NDCG at 10 is very bad. So we get even worse than the Mono T5 pipeline that we re-rank, and the score decreases to 0.42. So it is efficient, but from the effectiveness side, we should not use it because it decreases the effectiveness. So there should be something in between. And for the things in between, we test several sampling methods. So the first sampling method that we use is, or that we test is random sampling, just as a baseline, where we say, okay, from all the pairwise comparisons that would be available or possible, we just sample a fraction of possible comparisons. And as advantage, this approach would be parameter free, but of course, as disadvantages, it is not deterministic, and it does also not use the pointwise ranking that we previously made. Fix these problems, we also use a second sampling approach, so neighbor window sampling, where we just say, okay, we use the pointwise ranking that we have as a starting point, and there we compare each document to its M successors, as shown in the images. And the upside is, it is again parameter free, and it uses now the pointwise ranking, but in the downside, we have the problem that we only compare documents to its local neighbors, so we do not have global comparisons. And to allow also global comparisons, we use a skip window sampling approach, which is a modification of the previously neighbor window sampling, where we say, okay, we introduce an additional parameter, lambda, which is the step size of the skips. And there we say, okay, we compare each document to its four neighbors, but with a skip size of, for example, of lambda. As advantage, we now can also have local and global comparisons, but we have an additional parameter lambda that we have to tune. Now that we have some sampling methods, we can also, or we should deploy different aggregation methods. And here we use additive aggregation as one of the baseline, which is just a symmetric sum of the preference scores. This is the default in Duo T5 and so proposed by Pradeep et al. Additionally, we use Pradel-Terry aggregation, which is a maximum likelihood logistic regression. And we also use a greedy aggregation approach, which is from the 90s and which is basically additive aggregation, but it is iterative and greedy in the sense that we use additive aggregation to find the best document, so the document with the highest scores, and then we remove this highest scoring document from the remaining scores and select in that sense the next best document only on the remaining documents. This is the greedy aggregation, and we also use PageRank as one aggregation method so that we just have a graph-based aggregation scheme in our pool of methods. Yeah, the results that I want to show next are done on the MS Marco passage data set. We also have results for the CLUWebs, so CLUWeb 09 and CLUWeb 12 in the paper, but here I would focus on MS Marco. And in our ranking pipeline, we use BM25 with default parameters, and we re-rank the top 1000 documents with Mono T5 and then the top 50 documents with Duo T5. Here we see the main results of our evaluation, and I will guide you through these results in the next steps. So we see the four aggregation schemes, additive aggregation, Pradel-Terry aggregation, greedy aggregation, and rank aggregation. The dotted line on the bottom is the effectiveness of the pointwise method, and the dashed line at the top is the effectiveness of the pairwise of Duo T5 when we use all available pairwise comparisons. The x-axis is the sample rate and the y-axis is the effectiveness in terms of NDCG at 10. So the first interesting thing is that greedy aggregation is the most effective approach among all of the aggregation schemes. So the default for Duo T5 was additive aggregation, but this slightly modified version from the 90s called greedy aggregation, which also has nice theoretical properties, is more effective than the default of Duo T5. Also, we see that this greedy aggregation is the most effective one for all of the sampling methods. So when we see those three sampling lines where we successively increase the number of documents or of document pairs that we show to the approaches, then we see that greedy aggregation is the best one for all of the three sampling methods. Another interesting point is when we compare the neighbor window sampling with the skip window sampling approach, then we see that the skip window sampling is always more effective than the neighbor window sampling. And this means that the neighbor window sampling only had local comparisons, but the skip window thing had local comparisons and also global comparisons. This means that global sampling or the global context seems to be important here. Yeah, also the skip window sampling is the most effective approach among all of the aggregation methods, so it's better, more effective than random sampling and the offer sampling approach. When we now only look at the greedy aggregation at the top left, and then we see this line with a sampling rate of 30%, that in our experiments there is no statistically significant difference between using only 30% of the comparisons and 100%. So using 30% of the using only 30% of the pairwise comparisons, we still can get virtually the same effectiveness. And furthermore, if we only use 10% of the pairwise comparisons, we still have competitive effectiveness. So the delta is only in NDCG at 10, only at 0.04, which was statistically significant, the difference, but it's still maybe negligible compared that we only use 10% of the comparisons. So that would be the main content of the talk. To sum things up, we checked if we can make Duo T5 more efficient while maintaining the very good effectiveness. And for that, we sparsified the set of the comparisons, and we saw that it is indeed possible to have a more efficient version of Duo T5, which has the same effectiveness. So in our experiments, up to 90% of cost savings were possible. In the paper, we have additional experiments, for example, on the Clue webs with some more corroborating results. We, of course, make all of the code available. And as future work, we would like to extend or to increase the dev at the same budget. So we would like to go to the top to K100 or K150 or 200 that we re-rank, but at the same budget. And we would also like to use this approach in high recall search scenarios like technology assisted reviews or such things. That's it from my side. I would like to thank you for the attention.
Many thanks, Mike, for the talk.